approach to everything. And so the president sees it. He does. And he's a different president. That's what he ran on. That's what he got elected on. He sees himself as a true negotiator. I think it's what's even driving him crazy about the shutdown. He wants to negotiate. That is his favorite thing in the world to do, because that is a game he believes he can win. And one of the ways that he puts himself in a good negotiating position is to read the eyes of his adversaries and to get to know them and to get their know their tells and to talk to them. He doesn't want anyone else around him. Now, that doesn't fit in the way presidents should operate, the way foreign policy is conducted, the way that your staff needs to operate things. But he doesn't think his staff needs to operate things for him anyway, because he's in charge. He is the staff. So he's sort of like, who needs the notes? I'm the only person that makes any decisions around here.
But what argues against that is that when he came out of the meeting in Helsinki, he was sucking up, he was kissing up to Vladimir Putin so much. He was saying Vladimir Putin had offered this incredible offer to have, you know, their investigators come to the United States, and that he thought it was a great offer, and that Vladimir Putin had been so strong in his denial, by what Dan Coates said. I mean, the idea that he's a great negotiator, it doesn't seem in this case.
Well, I'm telling you how I believe that he views himself as a great negotiator.
Clearly,
also say that on policy, on the actual things that this administration and this government has done in regards to Russia, they have been tough. They have been tough. I mean, you have the vote today on the sanctions. Okay, there have been sanctions that have been put in place. We kicked out people after the London poisoning. They bombed in Syria against the direct wishes of the Russians. Mm. We sent lethal weapons to Ukraine to help them kill Russian soldiers. I mean, this administration has been pretty tough on a policy level. So what we end up talking about here is what were his notes and what were the conversations, as if he's a criminal and we have a right to know something there, which is presupposing something.
I don't want to get into a big argument about this, but he has not been tough on Russia. He's been in alignment with Vladimir Putin on incidents.
What policies has he not been tough on?
How about the Middle East? How about us spending years trying to get the Russians out of the Middle East, and now we've invited them back in to take over Syria? Is that really smart policy? He's giving him a pass on Ukraine. He's giving
him a pass.
How's he
giving
him
a pass when he's arming the Ukrainian?
He hasn't done anything serious
rebels.
About Ukraine. That is just it hasn't changed anything. But that's not the point I want to argue. I just think it's clear. Most people accept that. Anderson, presidents in the past have always wanted more secrecy than we would like to think. Mm. You know, they've often felt, for example, the White House phone system was intrusive because there might be an operator there listening to you, and who knew who was taking what notes. When President Nixon was in office and he dealt with the Russians, he actually asked Vernon Walters, our general, to serve as the interpreter. And Walters was so trusted by the Russians, he was the interpreter for both sides.
Is that right? Really?
Nobody else was in the room.
Wow.
You know, and so we don't even know if there are any notes left. But Trump, I imagine he threw them away.
Right. But we do know that the Russians have notes and likely very, very detailed notes. And you imagine that could be leverage over this president, given that they know what was in that conversation. The president, in that meeting, sort of thinking that he's negotiating on his own, not understanding that he's a representative of the American people, American interests, and we have a right to those notes.
Yeah, I totally agree with that. But one other point, though, is it's not just about his staff. It's really important that the Secretary of State and the Secretary of Defense, the National Security Advisor, the principals to the president, the people who are with him in the situation room at high-powered meetings, they need to know what's been said in those meetings.
Tillerson was with him in Hamburg, right?
He came out, he was very nondescript. But he's been in and out, and he didn't want to tell us very much. And he didn't really debrief the State Department.
No, not at all.
Yeah.
But the idea, you know, the New York Times has been reporting that that officials in the administration have had to try to glean information listening to what the Russians say was discussed in this meeting. I mean, that's a surreal situation. Like, that U.S. officials are eavesdropping on Russians to hear from the Russians what was discussed because they haven't been told.
And the idea that the president was, like, thinking, oh, I'm such a great negotiator, with all due respect to my friend. I mean, this is a president who loves an audience whenever he does anything. So if he really thought he was a good negotiator, I think he would have actually had a witness there and someone who could say, oh, look at all the things the president did. Mm. It just doesn't really stand up.
And, you know, the New York Times reported that the president called one of their reporters from the flight back saying, you know, Putin says he didn't do anything. He didn't do anything. He wasn't responsible for spying, and sort of making Putin's case so the New York Times would actually report that.
Yeah. Neil Katyal, thanks for being with us. Appreciate everyone else who's going to stick around. Coming up next, House Speaker Nancy Pelosi taking a poke at the president over the shutdown and the State of the Union. One White House official pokes back, essentially calling her justification for not hosting the president bogus. talk about the facts of her claim and the realities of the president's new political position now the Democrats control the House. And the attack that killed four Americans in Syria and the repercussions in the wake of the announced troop pullout and the president's claim of victory over ISIS.